Are we ready to rock? What's the time?
I don't know.
I can tell you much on my... We'd better wait till after.
Whoops. Whoops.
In my pocket.
It is.
When you can hear it ringing in the vestry.
Oh no.
Yeah. Oh, it's 32. Oops. Okay. That's fine. That's good Barnaby style.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone, and welcome. Lovely to see you. Lovely to have Edward playing our organ. And he came with his chauffeur, so that's okay. There are a few bits of changes which I will guide you along as we go, assuming I've got them right. Ruth, very sadly, who was supposed to be leading our service today, and it was supposed to be communion, is not very well, so she's had to stay at home today. But we will remember her in our prayers. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
And
be glad in it. Do we have any small people? Nope. So we stand now and sing our first hymn.
Fills the earth with ecstasy.
We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. As we gather to worship, let us remember that we come to God as one from whom no secrets are hidden, to ask for his forgiveness and his peace. And we say together, most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. May the God of love bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins, and assure us of his eternal life. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he set our sins from us. As the Father has compassion on his children, so is the Lord merciful towards those who feel him. Bless the Lord, O my soul, all that is in me, bless his holy name. Let us pray. Blessed are you, sovereign God, King of the nations. To you be praise and glory forever. From the rising of the sun to its setting, your name is proclaimed in all the world. As the Sun of Righteousness dawns in our hearts, anoint our lips with the seal of your Spirit, that we may witness to your gospel and sing your praise in all of earth. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. We now hear the psalm.
Great is the work of the Lord.
Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart, in the company of the upright, in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. Full of honour and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. Great are the works of the Lord. He has gained renown by his wonderful deeds. The Lord is gracious and merciful. He provides food for those who fear him. He is ever mindful of his covenant. He has shown his people the power of his works in giving them the heritage of the nations.
Great is the name of the Lord.
The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever, to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness. He has sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Great
is the
word
of the Lord.
Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have good understanding. His praise endures forever. Great are the works of the Lord.
The first reading is taken from Genesis. 14,
Our second reading is the second chapter of St. John's Gospel, verses 1 to 11. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had been also invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concerns it is that you and to you and me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now standing there were six stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. And Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them to the brim. And he said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine and did not know where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and be not wise in your own sight. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and be not wise in your own sight. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and be not wise in your own sight. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and be not wise in your own sight. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, take my words and speak through them. Take our minds and think through them. Take our hearts. Set them on fire with the love of you. In Jesus' name, amen. Many years ago, I was about 12 at the time, so it was many years ago, we were on a train travelling back from a family skiing holiday in Switzerland. And there were a lot of families on the train, and we ran out of water. Now, my mother was a very organised sort of person, and she had got several bottles of water with her. And she took pity on the family, which were lots of small children, on seats near us, because they didn't have anything to drink. So she gave them one of our bottles of water. And the family were so grateful that at the end of the journey, they gave us a bottle of wine. So you could say, water was changed into wine. And actually, there are many people who would like to explain away the miracles just like that. You hear people saying, "Oh, the feeding of the 5,000, they just shared all their bits and pieces together." But actually, this was not what happened at that wedding all those years ago in Cana of Galilee, much as some people would like to say it. Let's recap on the story. A wedding. Stress. A lot of stress. Anyone here who's planned a wedding knows they can be stressful. Am I right? Just imagine that the wedding not lasts not just a day, not even a weekend, but a whole week. And also imagine that you can't be selective about who you invite. You've got to invite the whole village and beyond. And then imagine that you have a major catering failure, the sort that would be talked about for years afterwards, is no off-license, Majestic Wine or supermarket round the corner. You can't run up to Bruce and Sibylla at High Clandon and say, can you lend us some bubbly to help out, please? No, this is a major social embarrassment. There'll be gossip for years to come. Oh, do you remember the Algio wedding when the wine ran out? We did feel sorry for them. Subtext, we would never let the wine run out at one of our family weddings. It's absolutely unthinkable. Fortunately, Jesus is at this particular wedding, as are his disciples and his mother. And quick on the uptake, it's his mother who somehow discovers that they're running out of wine. So she points it out to Jesus. Now, there's no evidence that she's actually asking or expecting him to do some sort of miracle. And she's certainly not telling him what to do. She's just putting the problem before him. And don't be put off by that seemingly abrupt response of his. Woman was a very respectful way of treating your mother. This is not the time for Jesus to reveal to the world who he is. This is going to come later, and it will be misunderstood even then by lots of people. This is, however, the time to help friends in need, and in doing so, to reveal to people who had eyes to see that this was no ordinary man. So, conveniently standing by are six huge stone water jars, each able to hold up to about 100 litres of water. That's quite a lot of bottles of wine. Now, these were not for drinking water, but for ceremonial washing. According to the religious laws, people became symbolically unclean by touching objects of everyday life. So before eating, they would pour water over the hands to cleanse themselves of any bad influences associated with what they just touched. So looking on, just imagine it, the disciples are aghast as Jesus tells the servants to fill these jars to the brim with water and draw some out and take it to the chief steward. What on earth is going to happen? Just imagine 13 pairs of eyes, I'm including Mary here, they're trained on the chief steward as he lifts the cup to his lips and drinks it, and takes another sip, and they're still watching. He likes it. He really likes it. And he turns to the bridegroom, and he says these words, which are now immortalized in our English language. Everyone serves the good wine first, and the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine till now. And the party goes on. And Jesus and his disciples melt into the background. But the disciples know what they have seen. And that is not just a miracle, but a glimpse of who Jesus really is. For this is not just a nice story about how Jesus helps some friends to avert a wedding disaster. It is that, but it's so much more. It's a sign, says John, because it points those who have eyes to see beyond the story to see who Jesus is. John places several signs like this at strategic places through his gospel. Moments when we see, as Tom Wright puts it, heaven opened and the transforming power of God's love bursting into the present world. Nothing is going to be the same again. Nothing is going to be the same again. First of all, the system's going to change. Remember that the water that becomes wine was drawn from these water jars that are used for purification rites. This is really important. No longer will people have to earn their way to heaven by going through all sorts of religious rituals to make themselves acceptable to God. Jesus will do this for them when he dies on the cross. People will come to understand that God loves them and calls them as they are, warts and all. So the system was going to change, but secondly, lives are going to change. The transformation of water the effect that Jesus will have on people's lives. And if you read on through the Gospels, we see how lives were transformed as they came into contact with him. For example, Nicodemus, a highly sophisticated Jewish teacher of the law, who was helped to understand that a relationship with God is so much more important than great learning. A Samaritan woman who had five or so husbands, plus another gentleman friend of questionable standing, whose life was turned upside down when she met Jesus. A tax collector who became wealthy working for the Romans and stealing for them from the common people, and who completely changed his ways and started giving money to the poor. A woman caught in adultery who came to understand that God loved and forgave her could help her to start again. And the thief on the cross who turned to Jesus at the very last minute and became one of the first to enter paradise. The insipid water of their lives has been changed into sparkling wine. For all these people, the encounter with Jesus was life-changing. And lives have continued to change all down history, through history, notably Saul of Tarsus, who approved of the vicious stoning of Stephen and went from house to house dragging out Christians to put in prison, and whose life was completely turned round on that Damascus road. A young man called Augustine, three centuries later, who led a dissolute, promiscuous life, enslaved by his passions. He was later to write that the bubbling impulses of puberty befogged and obscured my heart. It seized hold of my youthful weakness, sweeping me through the precipitous rocks of desire to submerge me in a whirlpool of vice. His encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ through the Bible completely turned his life around, and he became the great early church father known as Augustine of Hippo, beloved of Barnaby, as I think you'll know. Then there was John Newton, described in the book I'm reading at the moment as a greedy, foul-mouthed, blaspheming, cowardly, drunken, violent slaver. A deeply unpleasant chap, I think you'll agree, who amazed so many people and was amazed himself by the grace of God, which rescued him and transformed his life. The hymn Amazing Grace is one of the fruits of his transformation. These are dramatic stories, but as our gospel reminds us, when Jesus is present, amazing things happen. Does Jesus still change people today? I was listening to a podcast last week in which the scientist and mathematician John Lennox was being asked about his faith. Many people say to me, he said, you can't be a Christian and a scientist because Christianity is not testable. And I say to them, of course it's testable. Christ makes the claim that if we trust him, he will give us certain things. Peace, forgiveness, new life, new power. You can test that. In my life, I've met many people, he went on, and they may be in the middle of a broken relationship, dependence on drugs, all kinds of stuff. And you meet them 6 months later, and they're completely different. And you say, what happened to you? And they may express it in different ways. They may say, I was converted, or I became a Christian. But when you see it again and again, not only in yourself, but in people around you, you put two and two together, and you get four. I wouldn't, said this eminent scientist, sit here for a nanosecond as a Christian if I didn't believe it could be tested in real experience. What about us then? Can Jesus make a difference in our lives? Well, perhaps we're rather more, shall I say, respectable than some of the people I've mentioned. Or are we? We're really rather good at hiding what's going on inside. We're very good at putting on a show a great privilege to study the Bible with some of the ladies in there each week. They're not so good at pretending that all is well. And it's wonderful to see how God has worked in some of their lives and is changing them as they choose to walk with him. And I've found in my own darkest hours, and this may be your experience too, that when things get bad, God is there like a rock, helping me to find my footing again and to go forward. And for each of us, however sorted our lives may seem to be on the surface, there is this wonderful offer from Jesus Christ that as we try to follow him, as we walk every day with him and listen to his voice as he speaks to us through the Bible, and as we speak to him in prayer, and as we come together to worship like we're doing today, that we will find ourselves being changed. Changed from within, changed into his likeness, as St. Paul said. A process of ups and downs that takes a lifetime. But as we let the Holy Spirit work in us day by day, those wonderful fruits of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, and self-control will really begin to grow in our lives. And that is even better than the finest vintage champagne. Amen.
Let us now stand to declare our faith in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We sing now our offertory hymn, Christ Whose Glory Fills the Skies.
Oh,
We sit or kneel to pray.
Loving Father, recently we experienced storms Jocelyn and Isha, two of the many named storms forecast to affect us in the coming weeks. We give thanks that our part of the country escaped the full force of the winds and pray for those whose homes have been flooded or damaged by falling trees. Many households are still without power, which causes even more hardship for the elderly and vulnerable members of their community. We give sincere thanks for the emergency services and those who risk their own lives to rescue and care for those affected by the extreme weather. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful Lord, we ask you to watch over King Charles III, the Princess of Wales, and Sarah, Duchess of York, as they battle with and recover from their health issues. We ask you to support their families as they undertake more royal duties during the recovery period. We pray that they will all have a speedy return to full health. We ask you to watch over everyone who is suffering with physical or mental illness. Please ensure that they receive the correct and timely medical aid they need to overcome these problems. We think of their families, who also bear the worry and uncertainty as their loved ones are treated by our wonderful but overworked medical services. We pray for everyone in hospital, whether patients or staff, and ask you to lay your healing hands on them all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving Father, during these turbulent times, we pray for our leaders and the leaders of all nations around the world. May they seek the path of peace at all times and unite in the battle against terrorism and religious intolerance. Please guide their thoughts and actions towards ways of ensuring that all people can live in peace, safety, and harmony, with respect for each other's beliefs, customs, and traditions. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Finally, we pray for ourselves, our loved ones, and all those who contribute their time and talents to helping our church community, British Legion, Ashley Park, Cherry Trees, and Clandon School. Merciful Father, accept
these prayers
for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Gathering our prayers and praises into one, let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Thank you all for coming today and singing so beautifully. We could make a different choir, couldn't we? Lovely. And I'd like to thank Anne for reading, and Jane for doing. I was looking at Ingrid, and I think it wasn't Ingrid that did it. And Jane for her reading, and for the lovely, lovely prayers. Thank you. and Edward for leading us in this service. That's brilliant. And Ruth. Sue. Oh. I didn't sleep very well last night, and I've got granny brain quite severely now. So, Sue, thank you very much for that sermon. It actually contained two of my favourite things, science and wine. Some of you may already know, but I used to be a science teacher, favourite bit I've brought forward is the first law of thermodynamics. Anybody know what the first law? Energy can't be created or destroyed. So when we come, what we think is the end of this world, all our physical bits get back, put back in the ground and make the flowers grow. But everything else is carried on, isn't it? So all that energy within us is just amazing. All carried on with people that we've known, people that we've loved, people whose lives we've changed, and with God. Scientific proof. Well, that's my theory anyway. So, anyway. But just to let you know, there's coffee at the back. We'd love you to stay and have one. And you can also have a look at what we are planning to do for our church annex, which will make a huge difference, not only to the people who come to church, but also to people in the village where there'll be an active space and that things can happen. So we sing our final hymn, which is Christ Who's... No, it's not. We've just sung that. I the Lord of the Sea and Sky.
My people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin.
our final prayer is prayer number 2. God of power, may the boldness of your spirit transform us. May the gentleness of your spirit lead us. May the gifts of your spirit equip us to serve and worship you, now and always. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us all and those we love today and tomorrow and always. Amen.